men making them better fathers and stuff like that. So
it's a So they're funding that?
No, we were blessed. UAW gave me money, DTE, Ballmer Group, so State of Michigan. So yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah, people trying to make it happen, man. That's what's gonna make it happen, people. So I'm glad about that.
Yeah,
but they told you the we're about to start at 6:59. They told you the format. So you're gonna open up with a 2-minute opening and close with 2 minutes.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Okay. All right, sir. We're almost there. Phil, are we ready?
I am.
Okay, wait, Frank should be joining us.
I'm sorry.
Frank, are you there? Okay, we're live. And hello, everybody, and welcome to the initial CBTU Political Action Workshop Town Hall. I'm one of the hosts. I'm Michael Joseph, the first vice president of the Detroit branch of the CBTU, and our president, Frank Willis, will be joining us very shortly, and also our second vice president, Mr. Phil Holyfield, holding it down for us, our engineer, he'll be joining us as well. But we are happy and honored to have our initial Political Action Workshop Town Hall to be with the Senator from Michigan, Senator Gary Peters. Welcome, Senator Peters.
Michael, it's great to be with you. And if I may say, it's great to see you again. You and I go back a few years. I've been involved in a lot of endeavors, so it's really, really an honor to be with you again and appreciate you hosting this podcast.
Well, and thank you. I know it's been a busy day for you. I know you've got another event right after ours. So we're going to get right into it. So everybody, real quick ground rules. You'll be able to ask the Senator some questions. We have some people already submit questions before the program. At the last 8 minutes of the program, we're going to open it up so anybody that's online can talk to the Senator at the town hall. But also, if you have some questions, you can text those, and Phil and I will see those, and we'll share those with the Senator. So we'll open up right now, Senator. We want to give you an opportunity. Take 2 minutes and make your introduction, sir.
Well, again, I appreciate it, Michael. Thanks for having me on the podcast. Appreciate this opportunity. It's great to be able to take some questions from folks who are listening. Clearly, these are challenging times that we're in, and we're dealing with a public health crisis, economic crisis, and I know times are very hard for everybody. We all want to get back to a new normal, whatever that means, but we're pretty tired of what we've been going through. But I know we're all going to come together and make it happen. And I'm sure there are a lot of questions related to that and the work that I do in this area. But first, let me just say something about unions and how important unions are. That to me, we've got to make sure our unions are strong and vibrant. It's really about making sure we have a strong and vibrant middle class, and it's ultimately the union movement first gave that. The middle class would not have been created had it not been for unions, and we have to continue to stand up for them, and hopefully we'll have some questions related to that. A little bit about my background. I came from a union family. My father is a public school teacher for over 30 years, so he's part of the MEA. My mother worked in a nursing home. She was a nurse's aide and worked there for a number of years. And her story is particularly interesting. She wasn't a union place that she went to. And those of folks listening who know the job of a nurse's aide know that you're overworked, underpaid, and underappreciated for all the work that you do. And that was what she faced. And a lot of people went to her. They said, Mom, or not Mom, they didn't call her Mom. They called her Madeline. Said, Madeline, you know, why do you stay there?
You called her Mom, right?
I called her Mom. I did. I called her Mom. But she, they said, Madeline, why do you still work there? You know, it's not a nice place. The management's bad. And she said, I know that, but I really like the patients. I enjoy working with the patients. I've developed relationships with them. I care about them. So she said, I'm not leaving. Let's bring a union in here to stand up for the rights of the workers. So she was part of the organizing drive. They reached out to the SEIU and came in. And it was a tough time. I was a young man, and folks who've been involved in union drives know how tough that can be. You know, management tries to split people off. They offered her more money if she would not be part of the union movement and talk against it. And she said, no, you know, we're in this together. We went into it together. We're going to lock arms, and we're going to make sure that we get through this. And so she did. She hung in there. They won the and brought the union in. Then she became an SEIU union steward in her place to continue to do that. And I'm just so proud of her. She's still going strong. I just met with her a couple days ago. Again, like I see every week, she's 95 years old, but she's a tough woman then. She keeps to being a tough woman, and it really inspired me as to what is involved. And my parents told me, you know, anything that you want, you usually have to fight for, and being part of a union and doing it collectively makes a difference. And then I married into a union family too. My father-in-law is a proud member of the UAW, retirees chapter right now. So, you know, it's in my blood. It's why it's so great to be on this call and to understand that unions have been under attack by this current administration. The Trump administration has been attacking the ability for men and women to collectively bargain for fair wages, for good health care, to be able to retire with dignity after you put in your whole life of work. Those are basic rights that every American should have. We need to fight for them every day. And the men and women in the union movement are the folks who fight for it every day. And when you're successful, everybody is.
That was one of my questions I was going to ask you. Who is Gary Peters? Because your opponent is framing you in a totally different way than what people who have known. But you've been talking about unions. Let me ask you a question. Do you think that the government thinks unions are obsolete?
Well, I certainly think the Trump administration believes that, and they're trying to do everything they can to undermine. In fact, the person they put in as the Secretary of Labor is basically an attorney that was a union buster. That's who they put in charge of the Labor Department, which is about standing up for the rights of working men and women, strengthening unions. So there is an attempt to do that. They passed legislation, and quite frankly, this new Supreme Court nominee that Donald Trump is trying to push through will likely make it even more difficult for folks to come together and unionize, which is why it's so important that we are electing folks who understand the importance of labor, push back. You know, I'm a proud sponsor of legislation and a lead sponsor of legislation to strengthen the rights to collectively bargain, the rights for folks to actually organize, to have fair elections for a union to go into a place. We have to know, and you know, it's interesting when you know, to your the point about strong union, strong country. If you look at a graph of the middle class, and the middle class has been declining in this country over the last couple decades, and that line just about correlates directly with union membership as it goes down. As union membership goes down, so does the livelihood of middle class folks, which why, to me, if we're going to have a strong country, and I don't believe you can have a strong country if you don't have a strong middle class. One, for an economy, you got to have people that have money in their pockets in order to have a strong economy that can go out and buy things. And a democracy, you need to have a middle class that stands up for the rights of everybody in the country. So we have to reverse that. No question, there are forces against unionization and unions. Ultimately, we all will pay a price for that. So we've got to step up. And
one thing you brought up, we want to talk about the Supreme Court nomination that's coming up. But also, and since let me ask you a question, I'm being very serious here. Do you pay more taxes than Donald Trump?
Yes, I do. I think most all Americans do.
Well, what would you tell the people here in Michigan? We've been joined by our great president. We'll say hello. Frank, opportunity to say hello to the senators. This is Frank Woods, everybody, the president of the Detroit chapter of the CBTU.
Hey, Frank.
Hey, Gary. How you doing today?
I'm well. Thank
Glad you. To have you on. Glad to have you speaking to our members about the issues that are before us, especially African Americans and our constituency groups like CBTU. And I don't know if you know, but you know, African Americans make up the largest part of the labor movement, like by 17%. And women are actually the fastest growing sector. So it is definitely important and imperative that we try to strengthen the NLRB and the things that are going on there. And are there ways that we can do that when we appoint, whether appointments can be adjusted? How can we make that happen? I guess that's a follow-up question to what Michael was saying.
Yeah, it's a really important question. And those appointments and folks that are put in those places are appointed by the president. So that's why it is so important that we elect a president who cares about labor unions and wants to strengthen those. And certainly that's why I'm supporting Joe Biden, his long history of being a champion for the labor movement. It's critically important. But I'll say, when you're dealing with appointments like the Secretary of Labor that I mentioned, it's not just the president that's important. We have to have a Democratic majority in the United States Senate. It's plain and clear. You will, if Joe Biden, when he becomes president, if he appoints folks that are pro-labor, if you have Mitch McConnell and his, and the Republicans in charge of the Senate, they will not confirm. They will not allow that to go through. And when you think about it, just remember when President Obama was our president, how Mitch McConnell stood in the way of everything President Obama tried to do and blocked him, including blocking a Supreme Court justice. That was, we may say this was several months before an election. Republicans said that was not right for President Obama to have that nomination. Clearly they think different with President Trump now jamming the Supreme Court nomination when they denied President Obama a nomination many months earlier than that. So you really got to do both. You know, you've got to win the presidency, but you have to have a majority in the Senate. And so that's why Michigan is such a central focus right now. You know, I'm running against a guy named John James who says he supports Donald Trump 2,000%. That's a pretty big percentage. It's really clear what's at stake here.
No, I'm just doing a follow up about, but we can get to John James later.
Yeah.
No, I want to tie in what you're saying, Senator, and Frank and I discussed this earlier. And the things you talked about, again, our questions about the Michigan workers, you know, who are suffering, who pay their taxes, but also you brought up the Supreme Court nominee who may vote against the Affordable Health Care Act. What about healthcare, and what do you plan on doing about it if you're reelected?
Yeah, absolutely. Healthcare to me is that it's a right. Everybody in this country, no matter who you are, no matter where you live, should have access to quality, affordable healthcare. Bottom line, it's a right. And that's why right now we certainly have to protect the Affordable Care Act, as you mentioned. We've got a tax from the Trump administration that actually has a lawsuit to basically throw it out, which will be coming before the court. In fact, it comes before the Supreme Court just a few week or so after the election in November. And we know this justice by what she has written, and she's written that she basically believes it's unconstitutional. We know where she's going to vote, and she's going to be the vote in the Supreme Court that will throw it out if she's confirmed. And what does that mean for people when we think of President Obama's signature accomplishment? It means that right now, protections for people who may have pre-existing conditions, and that's over 1 million people in Michigan. Well, I think it's 1.3 last I saw, who have a pre-existing condition right now or can get quality, affordable health care. In the bad old days, you were discriminated against. You couldn't get it, or if it was available, it was a price that no one could afford. The Affordable Care Act changed that. The Affordable Care Act changed the way seniors pay for prescription drugs. If they went into a donut hole, they end up paying a whole lot more money and often had to make very difficult choices between medicine and food. The Affordable Care Act made sure that wasn't happening. Keeping your children on policies till they're 26, having free screenings. You know, when you go in and have basic screenings for healthcare, there's no copay. That's the Affordable Care Act. This justice, if confirmed, and they're rushing her through so she will hear the case. If she's confirmed after that, she would be after the case and wouldn't be able to rule on it, but they're making sure that she's there for a good reason. They want to throw all of that out. That would be a major step back. So to answer your question, my first goal is we got to protect the Affordable Care Act and then expand it and to make sure that people have the opportunity, that more people have it, and we lower the cost. One thing that I'm really focused on is lowering the cost of prescription drugs. I mean, that's the thing. Those prices just keep going up. It's not the inflation rate. It's really high. We've got to rein in the big drug companies. That's why I've introduced and passed legislation to bring more competition in the marketplace, for example, from generics. When generics come into the marketplace, all the prices drop. It's pretty dramatic. Big drug companies try to stop that. We've got to turn that around. And when I talk about seniors too, you know, Medicare can't do something that every major company can and any big customer. Medicare can't negotiate. This is hard to believe. They cannot negotiate with drug companies for cheaper drugs. That makes no sense. You know, if you're a big customer, if you're General Motors, for example, you can go and you can negotiate for lower drug prices.
Right.
Medicare can't. And Mitch McConnell, Republicans refuse to put that bill on the floor. When we have the majority, we'll put it on the floor and we'll work to bring down drug prices.
And that's what I want to talk about. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Frank.
I have a question. Because one of the things I rarely hear discussed in the Affordable Care Act, Obamacare, is mental health. There's a very big discrepancy in the African American community, how we're affected by mental health. In the city of Detroit, currently, there's probably less than 50 mental health beds. How can we strengthen the Affordable Care Act to address those issues in our community, because it's definitely a huge impact.
Oh, it's absolutely huge. We underfund mental health by substantial amounts. We have a number of pieces of legislation to do that. Again, we can't get it through the Senate, but you just got to put more resources in it. As you said, there's a shortage of beds in Detroit. There's a shortage. It's really really bad in Detroit and in communities of color, but it exists everywhere. We have to deal with mental health, and we know that mental health issues are every bit, if not more, devastating than a lot of physical health issues. And so it has not been addressed the way it should be, and it's a major focus of mine.
Senator, there's another piece of mental health that has not been addressed as it should be, and that is racism in America. We see what the Breonna Taylor case is all about. We see the BLM movement, Black Lives Matter, and the violence that has happened that necessarily does not come from the Black Lives Matter people, but it is out there. What is your thoughts on that? Let's hear what you have to say about the Breonna Taylor situation, policing, police reform. Where does Gary Peters stand on that?
Well, we have to enact police reform, and we got to stop talking about it. We've been talking about this for way too long. Now is the time for action. And we had a moment. We can't let it go. We got to keep pushing to have that moment to put in some common sense things to go forward. You know, I certainly was appalled by the image that all of us saw with George Floyd and that knee on his neck. You know, it was to see that video and what that video did to awaken a country to what happens was powerful. And certainly I'll never get that image out of my head. That is something that just screams for justice. You mentioned Breonna Taylor as well, another situation where that should have never, ever happened. And we'll talk about the how we have to have independent investigations in a minute. But what we also have to realize, and I remind folks when I can, is that, you know, you've seen the videos, but stuff like that happens that's not on a video. It's happening. It's happening during every week and in the month. You're seeing things. So there are other folks that are dealing with that every day, and we have to take action. So I support legislation. And let me just say, you know, obviously we've got to change the hearts and minds of people in this country. It's a big issue, but we can help change the hearts and minds of people by moving some meaningful legislation that makes a clear statement that this kind of stuff will not be tolerated. We will not accept it. So, you know, I support legislation, for example, to ban chokeholds. We don't need to talk about that anymore. We don't need to discuss it. It just is not appropriate. We can do that. I also believe that we must have independent investigations when a police officer has been charged with wrongdoing. It should not be done within the department. As both of you know, you need to have trust in the community. The community has to have trust in law enforcement. And if you have investigations that go right within the department and then someone's cleared, that doesn't build trust. People are going to say, you know, that's just the good old boy network protecting their own again. And we want to have a fresh set of eyes looking at it and full transparency. That's what's wrong with about Breonna Taylor. You know, here we had a situation where we don't have full transparency. You don't have that independent review. The community's not going to trust it. I just saw before this podcast, a new videotapes came out from the cams. They're incredibly disturbing. Why wasn't that out before and part of the investigation? It's, you know, this, we have to bring light to that. The other, and I'm sorry to take a lot of time on this, but I know it's important. The other issue or the bill that I support and I'm working on and I've sponsored is to deal with one thing that we know is very, very effective, and that's community policing, where law enforcement folks know the community and the community know them. And how do we incentivize to have more people who live in the community to work in law enforcement? You know, to recruit people. So I've introduced legislation that will create a grant program that if you live in the city of Detroit, you grew up in Detroit, and you want to go into law enforcement, you can have your police academy all paid for, all of your criminal justice coursework, all that you have to do to become a police officer, it's all paid for. And you don't have to pay it back, provided you agree to work 4 years in your local police department. And what I've heard is if people stay there 4 years, they're probably going to spend a whole lot more time. So you're recruiting young men and women from the community to serve their community is the kinds of things that are important.
Richard, I want to circle back a little bit. So what would be your plan? What would you say that you as a senator in the United States Senate to fight systemic racism? What would you propose that we do when we have people who are denied opportunities simply for the color of their skin, for the way that they love, for the way for who they worship?
Well, absolutely. Well, first off, we got to call it out when you see it, and it's unacceptable. Then there are ways that we need to address and understand that there are disparities. One area that I've worked on and just passed actually a bill out of committee that now goes to the Senate floor deals with the disproportionate impact of natural disasters on communities, particularly communities of color. We certainly saw that with the COVID crisis here in Michigan, with 40% of the deaths with African Americans, even though the African American population is 14%. You know these numbers well, and that's a disproportionate impact. We've seen it all too often with other natural disasters. Think of the hurricane in New Orleans and the impact that that had on a community of color disproportionately and everywhere else. So we're creating a unit within FEMA, the Federal Emergency Management folks, to focus on community inclusion and civil rights, understand that some communities get hit harder and they need a whole lot more help. They need a lot more resources to get them through. But it's not just in a disaster. To your point, we've got to make sure people have opportunities. Before that, everyday life, that means healthcare, which is why the Affordable Care Act, back to that, is important. If the Affordable Care Act is thrown out the way the Republicans want, you're talking about hundreds of thousands of people in Detroit that suddenly now don't have healthcare while we're in the middle of a pandemic, which is outrageous. The other thing that I spend time working on is that we want to make sure that small businesses are created in communities, in our neighborhoods. It's not just about the downtown areas, it's about throughout our neighborhoods. And one of the hardest things that businesses face is getting the money, the capital, to borrow money to be able to actually start their business, particularly in neighborhoods. That's why I've introduced legislation called the Community Investment Act that puts money into the minority depository institutions. These are the institutions that are in these communities or make most of the loans in those communities. But oftentimes they don't have a deposit base that's big enough to support a lot of loans or loans to small business. So my legislation has the Federal Reserve inject capital into the bank that can then loan that money out to small businesses. But because it's about folks having the opportunity to live their version of the American dream, start a business, hire people, you know, build a community going forward. There's just so much we have to do. Those are some of the things specifically I'm working on. But clearly, that's a long list that we have to deal with.
Go ahead, Frank.
No, I was going to, I know in the future, when you win, the issue now before us in the African-American community is we need to see more Gary Peters and hear more about these initiatives that you are involved in that surround communities of color, not just here in Detroit, in Flint, Pontiac, across the state. We're blessed to have 5 chapters around the state of Michigan, and we represent the communities of color. Will you be available after you win? Because we're going to make sure that we make sure to get you out, get your vote out to make sure that you win. Will you commit that we can get you back on some Zoom calls to talk about some of these initiatives that we don't hear about? We don't hear about this at the ground level, and that's where the rub is. We don't hear about these at the ground level. We need to hear about them. What do you feel about that?
Oh, well, I welcome that. Absolutely. That's the one beauty now of Zoom. I can Zoom all over the state, and the only travel is getting coffee from my kitchen. So there's no excuse for me not to be on Zoom calls to be chatting with you about this. So, you know, I'm in Washington during the week, so it's often tough to travel around Michigan because I'm in Washington, D.C. But now with the power of Zoom, we can do this from D.C. and give you an update of what's happening. And I'd certainly welcome that and look forward to that.
Okay, Senator, we're near the end, and I want to give you an opportunity to close up. So a couple of quick ones, throw some quick ones at you. This one's from Kevin Tolbert. And I'm going to paraphrase it. He's basically saying, why do the Democrats in the Senate allow themselves to be bullied by the Republicans, whether they're in the majority or in the minority? It seems like the Democrats don't have their act together. What's your response to that, sir?
Well, no, I think we push back very aggressively on the Republicans, but we also have to remember that in the Congress, it's all about who has the votes. So the Republicans control the floor. They control what actually goes on the floor to be voted on. And so it's all about votes, and that's why we need to have the majority. I'm in the minority. It's certainly a whole different dynamic, which is why elections matter. The good news is that we really have a real shot to take the majority in the U.S. Senate. We need to pick up 4 seats. We have 4 states where we think we can win, but we also have to hold Michigan, because I'm a Democrat in a state that Donald Trump won. They're coming at me aggressively. They're pouring in money. I've got out-of-state billionaires pouring in money to support my opponent, because they know if I don't hold this seat, it's a lot harder for us to have the majority in the Senate. And we can't move the things, what we've talked about here on the call, expanding health care for folks, protecting labor rights and labor organizing and bargaining rights, making sure we're dealing with the systemic issues of racism, and having meaningful police reform. All of those things will happen if we have the majority, but you need to have the votes to put it forward. And then if we have the majority and we don't do that, then call us out, because clearly we failed. But when we're in the minority, you have to realize we need the votes to do it. We can get up on the floor and we can make a speech and we can try to delay things, but nothing replaces the fact of having the majority and actually writing these things into law.
So, sir, we're at the end of the program, because we promised we'd let you go at 7:29 for another one. So if you answer this question, and Frank may have a follow-up as well, let us know, what does Gary Peters plan on doing for the citizens of the state of Michigan? What was it that you wanted to accomplish that you didn't accomplish, and what do you plan on accomplishing?
Well, I'm going to continue to, I want to grow opportunities for folks. I've been doing that, but I want to do a lot more. We've got a long ways to go. And how do we make sure that everybody has the opportunity to live their version of the American dream? And, you know, one aspect that I focused on is skills training, that we have to do more to make sure that folks have the opportunity to have skilled trainings, get into apprenticeship programs. We have shortages of folks in these jobs. And as you know, these are great jobs that pay really well. I just passed legislation that was signed into law by the president to expand opportunities for veterans coming off of active duty to come back to their community and to use their GI Bill more widely than they can now to get into apprenticeship programs, and also leading to good paying union jobs in most cases. But we need to go beyond that. We have to keep moving. It's not just about veterans. As important as they are, we want to make sure we have their back when they come home. Everybody needs to have those opportunities. I've always been a believer that everybody chooses a different path in life, but everybody should have the same opportunity. And that still is something we have to keep working towards, and I'm going to be committed to do. If reelected, we'll continue to build on the work that I've already done.
Yeah, I'm going to follow up on that real quick. The skilled trade is very big with the CBTU. Our skilled trades corner, Vince Giles, we've assisted with a lot of pre-apprenticeship programs. Mm-hmm. Pre-apprenticeship programs are great because they get the folks right to where they can pass the test. The biggest issue is after they pass the test. And many of them pass the test, but they get failed in the interview. Get failed in the interview by the corporations that don't want to see African Americans come into those higher paying jobs. So we have to help us do a better job of breaking down those barriers that we can get African Americans and the people of color those jobs.
Yeah, absolutely. And we have to. You're absolutely right. And that's obviously that's inexcusable that happens through the interview process. Particularly when I'm sure many of those candidates have some of the higher scores as well, and yet suddenly that happens. Absolutely unconscionable. The other thing that I think is important too is that we need to see more recruiting for these apprenticeship programs and the opportunities in our communities. Oftentimes they go other places looking for folks, and that's not acceptable. And you have great hardworking folks in our urban areas, in other communities. They need the opportunity to take that test in the interview, and unfortunately, many of them don't even have that opportunity. So we definitely have to fix that in the upfront too.
Okay. Well, Senator, again, we're at the end of the program. I'm going to ask you, hey, come back next month. We still have some issues. Frank and I have some more questions we want to ask you. But we thank you for your time tonight. Like I said, I promised your team we get you off the air. Can we get you to come back in October?
Yeah, I'll have to, that will check my record, it's, or my schedule. October, you know, will be really busy, but I'll make every effort. I'll make every effort. But definitely November for sure.
Listen, again, on behalf of our entire membership, our president, Frank Woods, our vice presidents, Lois Lofton and Phil and Holy Phil, and of course, our great secretary, Tracy Dye, we thank you, sir, for taking the time to talk with us. And again, I'm gonna ask you again to come visit us again.
I will.
We wish you the best in your endeavor, and we know you'll do what's good for the United States of America and for the great state of Michigan. Thank you, sir, for being here.
Well, thank you, gentlemen. Great to see you. Thank you. Stay healthy. Stay safe. Take care.
You too.
All right.
Thank you. So, Frank, you. Great job as always, my brother. We're almost at the end. You want to tell the people about our GOTV?
Yeah, we were blessed. I believe I sent it to Phil, and I sent it out. I had Tracy send it out to you. There's an opportunity for us to do a phone bank, a virtual phone bank, where we can contact our members, the people in our circles and in our families in our circle, the people across the state, about getting out to vote. So we definitely need your help with that. We want your assistance. And please sign up. I mean, this is so important that we get this out. We can't do the normal that we would take people to the polls. Although there are programs out there, but we can't participate in that because of liability issues this time around. But going forward, from this day on, October, it has to be a busy month for us to get the vote out. Yes. We have to get the vote out. We got to participate.
I got my absentee ballot today, and you don't have to mail it. Like Frank and I talked today, what you can do, you can go up to your clerk's office or when you get it in the mail and turn around
drop
and throw it out and throw it in the ballot and turn around and go home. Voting on that same day is very important. So again, I want to thank everybody. Frank, I think we had a pretty good first one. We've got some coming up, everybody. The Secretary of State will be here to talk to you about voting process. We're going to talk about the historical and the current voter suppression that's going on. Ben Crump will be on our program. We have a lot of great ideas coming at you, everybody, for our political action workshops coming up in the future.
All right. Here. Thank you, Mike. Good, excellent job. Everybody give Mike a round of applause. Did a great job. Yeah. Putting this together.
Give me a cheeseburger, okay? No, you know what you give Michael? That your word, you're going to fill out the census and you're going to go vote. That's all I like to hear.
All we can. Get out and vote. And we got signs at the vote center. So if you want to come.
Where's the vote center at, Frank, of people that may not know?
Vote center is 15140 Liminois.
And wait a second there. When are you there?
Monday through Friday, 10 to 6, and Saturday, 12 to
right.
Hi. How y'all doing?
We're going to have another. Hey, how you doing?
Hey, this is Terry. This is Ishmael Terry.
Yes. Hey. Hello. How you doing, sir?
Hey, how you doing? Y'all did a great job. I was very impressed with what I saw. And Frank and Mike, I wanted to talk with you guys about, you know, I'm in Lansing back again as the legislative policy director up in the 9th district. And so I want to talk with you guys about how I can be included in getting the message out about voting. Okay, I'm utilizing your guys' efforts. I do have some packets already given by Council President Brenda Jones, and I'd like to get some information from you guys so I can bring it to the district as well to get people more inclusive and transparency when it comes to being in the district to understand about being a voter. That's especially correct. The gentlemen who are coming out of prison.
Yes.
Who are making that transition from being incarcerated to being back on public life.
Our returning citizens, we're going to do that. And speaking, that's a great transition for us, everybody. I want to give you a personal invitation. This Saturday, October 3rd, from 9 a.m. until noon, we'll be at the Silver Garden Event Center. That's on Southfield Road between 9 Mile and 10 Mile. From 9 to noon, we're going to be giving free COVID swab testing. You'll have a chance to get a blood pressure test, HIV testing, and free flu shots. Stay in your car. You don't have to get out. We're also going to have food for you and a lot of gift cards and a lot of great things. If you have young people from the ages of 13 to 19, they can get testing too with a parent or a guardian. Please bring your ID, wear your mask, come get healthy. We're going to fight this disease, everybody. Hope to see you this Saturday, Silver Garden, sponsored by Farm UAW. I want to thank Roy Gamble for his organization helping us putting this together, along with DTE and a bunch of other folks. So please, Saturday, 9 a.m. until noon, we'll be at the Silver Garden on Southfield Road between 9 Mile and 10 Miles, all free.
And if you guys have the time, October 14th, we're hosting a giveaway, grab and go giveaway at 11406 Littlefield at State Representative Karen Winsett's home. We're doing giving hand sanitizers and PPEs to any and everyone who shows up.
Okay. We're also planning a get out to vote over at the Vote Center. So I'm going to need CBTU members. We'll be discussing it at our next meeting, which is October, 10th? Yeah, October 10th. So we'll be talking about that in the near future. You'll be getting some updates. Yep.
Okay.
And Frank, can we have a special thank you to Phil Holderson? Everybody give it up for Phil. He held it together. He always does. Thank you, Phil.
Thank you, Phil.
You're welcome.
Y'all did a great job.
Very good. Very good job.
Phil.
All right. Appreciate you all.
Rich.
Who is that?
All right.
We'll see you at the next one, everybody. Remember, CBTU in the community, doing it for you. Communication is important. Voting is important, but voting with knowledge is more important.
Make sure you're here.
Educated voter. It's the best voter.
Good night,
everybody.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.
All right.